endocrinology, and Dr. Aroma Oberoi, professor microbiology from CMC, to come and chair the session. I request our chairpersons to please introduce our speaker.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce the speaker of this session, Dr. Chetna. She is founder and chairperson of GC and professor. She was professor in the Department of Gastroenterology, PGI Chandigarh. Ma'am's areas of interest are infectious diseases, gastrointestinal ailment, development of rapid diagnostic tests, and teaching and training the students. Ma'am has immense exposure to the research and different projects like Campylobacter diarrheas, endotoxin estimation, myeloperoxidase activity. List is too long, and ma'am has got also area of specialization as in medical microbiology, and member of professional bodies like American Society for Microbiology, Indian Association of Medical Microbiologists, Indian Association of Leprologists, Indian Society for Gastroenterology, and National Academy of Medical Sciences. So over to ma'am.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My greetings from Chandigarh, and at the outset, I want to thank the chairpersons for kind words, and also to Dr. Raju Singh Chinha and Dr. Deepinder Chinha for inviting me here as a speaker. And I want to congratulate the whole team for the successful organization of this conference. And I shall be speaking about the association of Clostridium difficile infection in patients with specific underlying disease. Actually, I've kept all my slides very lazy because I thought yesterday Dr. Rama Chaudhary would have taken the antibiotic associated diarrhea and she would have covered C. difficile in detail. So now, whatever lack is there, you will have to ask me during the discussion time. I shall be giving a very, very little introduction of Clostridium difficile. And we are all aware of the fact that Clostridium difficile is an important cause of healthcare associated infections. Earlier in India, we were not much wondering that Clostridium difficile is there, though it was existent since a very, very long time. But the awareness is getting nowadays, we are all getting more and more aware of this disease, and it is being reported from different parts of our country also. And Clostridium difficile, this organism produces three different kinds of toxins. One is toxin A and toxin B. Both of these are responsible for the pathogenicity of the disease. Then there is another toxin, the binary toxin, which the pathogenicity of which has not, which is not very clear. Only 2% of the C. difficile isolates harbors binary toxin alone, whereas 4 to 12% of C. difficile harbor along with toxin A and toxin B. Uh, So the common clinical symptoms in C. difficile infection, of course, we are all aware of it. We have fever, abdominal cramping, diarrhea, and as a result of diarrhea, there is dehydration. And always when there is colitis or something, there will be increased in the fecal leukocytes. So CDI thus presents with a wide range of clinical presentation, right from diarrhea to colitis to pseudomembranous colitis to toxic megacolon. And in some of the patients, it leads to death, particularly in cases of outbreaks and all. C. difficile is the causative microbe for 15 to 25% of antibiotic-associated diarrhea, 50 to 75% of antibiotic-associated colitis, and almost all cases of pseudomembranous colitis, though sometimes there was a report of pseudomembranous colitis because due to Klebsiella or due to a viral etiology. But almost all cases are attributed to C. difficile infection. Then in recent years, as you know, when the hypervirulence strain NAP1, B1, O27 started emerging, we also all, we became aware that there is an increase in occurrence of this disease, both also in severity, and then there is considerable morbidity and mortality also in the hospitalized patients because of this. So the C. difficile is a C. difficile infection is a mounting public health challenge. So in 2009, we published all the established and potential risk factors for Clostridium difficile infection, and among the drugs, we have antibiotics in which about 95 to 98% of development of CDI has been attributed to antibiotics. Then proton pump inhibitor, now Dr. Sood recently covered this proton pump inhibitors because over-the-counter availability is there. This is also causing about 1.5 to 2-fold rise in CDI. Then, of course, immunosuppressive agents and cancer therapeutics also have been reported from time to time to cause C. difficile infection. Then we have the host risk factors. Age, of course, we know more than 65-year-old people are more prone to develop CDI. Then not only because of impaired immunity, also because of prolonged hospital stay, because of several comorbidities. And so under host risk factors, we have age, underlying diseases, that is comorbidities, impaired immunity, either because after 65 years, our immunity also becomes impaired, and also because you have to take some immunosuppressives for something or the other. So all these causes are there, which are the host risk factors. Beyond this also, we have lot of other risk factors, such as environmental risk factors, like C. difficile, if you acquire a toxigenic strain, and the how toxigenic one particular strain of C. difficile is there, and all that. There are several other factors associated, but I shall be focusing my talk to patients who are having comorbidities and CDI, because that is what my talk is about. And this was a study, this was a 3-year-old data which we had collected and published, in which we found that in the patients of more than 3,000, the 90% patients had diarrhea, 36% of the patients had abdominal pain, and 40.6% of these patients had fever. Then, then CDI was seen in relation to major antibiotic groups received by this patient, and we found that nitroimidazole, penicillin, quinolone and glycopeptides, even carbapenems and aminoglycosides, these were the drugs which were taken, and the association of CDI is 17 to almost 22% in this different group of patients who used antibiotics. Then we also looked for this patients according to age group. Infants, of course, we receive very few number of patients, only cases that are suspected are sent. Earlier, of course, we used to receive lot many patients in the infant group also, and we received maximum patients in the adult group more than 18 to 60 years, and we found that there was no significant association with age group compared to the sample size, because in this group we are having a large sample size, more than 2000, I think it is 2057 patients in this particular group. So among these patients we found we looked for CDT positivity associated with various clinical conditions, and we found these patients having gastrointestinal disease, renal diseases, surgical conditions, blood diseases, hepatic disorders and cancers, and these were the cases of CDT positivity which I have graphically also shown here. Here you see these are the different underlying diseases, conditions in which gastrointestinal conditions were seen to have the highest number of CDI cases, and this is in descending order with different groups of the underlying disease conditions. So thus there are several comorbidities which have been seen to be associated with CDI, and the available studies are mainly on inflammatory bowel diseases, malignancies and solid organ transplantation. So we also thought of looking for our association of inflammatory bowel disease with CDI, and we had 721 patients in the IBD group. Most of these patients were having ulcerative colitis. There were a few cases of patients, I think just four patients were with Crohn's also. And we took equal number of gender match control patients. CDI was found to be associated with non-IBD cases, and 20%, that is 20% CDI cases were found in the non-IBD group, and 16% in the IBD group, and this was not found to be significant. Non-IBD group patients were, when compared to IBD group, we found that these non-IBD groups were relatively older in age, and watery diarrhea and fever was more linked to this non-IBD group compared to the IBD group, and this was found to be highly significant. Then when we compared the IBD patients to the non-IBD group, we found that bloody stool and abdominal pain symptoms were more common in the IBD group, and the duration of diarrhea was also longer in the IBD group, and both of these are also highly significant. Of course, the patients improved significantly in most of these parameters at follow-up, and the prevalence of CDI in both IBD and non-IBD groups were found to be comparable. And clinical symptom and age of presentation, as I have already discussed earlier, varied in both of them. But contrary to our expectation, IBD was not a risk factor for CDI in our setting. In malignancy, we see this is a recent review paper in which we saw that CDI was reported in 54.2% of cases with hematological malignancies. And coming to solid organ transplantation, 22% CDI was reported as hospital acquired cases in liver transplant patients. So we also plan to do a study to see in our data, to analyze our data, and to see the association of TDI in patients with specific underlying comorbidities. We had 340 patients of pancreatic disease, 245 patients of hepatic disease, 408 patients of renal disease, and malignancy patients we had 507. And all these patients we compared with control patients who were also sent for C. difficile toxin investigation. These control patients did not have any of these diseases, nor they had IBD, because we had already studied the IBD group. So this constituted the control group of patients, and we found that the frequency of diarrhea was almost the same in all the groups, but the duration of diarrhea was more in the renal group as well as in the control groups, but not so in the other group. Then coming to the percentage group distribution of TDI, there was highest association seen with the pancreatic disease group. CDT was present in 30.6% of the patients, but lowest in the renal disease group, that is, it was 17.9%. And these are the different percentage of CDT positivity in these patients. The Canadian Nosocomial Infection Surveillance Program showed that of 1,430 cases, 62 patients had CDI, and 62 patients with CDI had underlying hepatic disease. And CDI was common among cirrhotic patients with hepatorenal syndrome, and CDI independently increased mortality in cirrhotic hospitalized patients as reported by Bajaj et al. In our study, we found that CDI was associated with 19.6% of hepatic disease patients, and use of antibiotics was highly significant. Among the renal diseases, 39 CDI cases were found among 600 patients with kidney transplant and 102 patients with pancreas kidney allograft transplant, and this was more common among patients with this pancreas and kidney allograft transplantation. Eric et al. Reported CDI in a 82-year-old male who had acute renal failure, and Yui et al. Retrospectively investigated 85 CDI patients, and they reported that chronic kidney disease was an independent risk factor for CDI in that is, CDI was more common in patients with CKD than the other group of patients. So several other workers also have shown that patients with chronic kidney disease have higher risk of CDI. In our study, we found that 17.9% of renal disease patients were present having CDI, and the duration of diarrhea was also significant compared to other comorbid groups. Among malignancy, patients with hematological malignancy, post-transplant and post-chemotherapeutic patients, as well as patients with solid cancers, they are vulnerable to CDI. And for this, multiple risk factors exist, particularly the extended hospital stay, exposure to multiple antibiotics, and these patients receive repeated cycles of chemotherapy also. And GI mucosal damage occurs because of the conditioning regimen, radiation, and graft versus host disease of GI tract. And all these things serve as independent risk factors for CDI development. And in addition to this, when these patients receive antibiotics, it further increases the risk of acquiring CDI. In our study, we found that CDI was associated with 21% of malignancy patients, and use of antibiotics was also found to be highly significant. Coming to pancreatic diseases, which was one of our groups of underlying disease patients, we could not find any literature relating to CDI with pancreatic disease. And in our study, we found that CDI was associated with 30.6% of patients in pancreatic disease group, which was highly significant compared to all other specific groups, such as the malignancy group, renal disease group, hepatic disease group, as well as with the control patients. And use of antibiotics was again found to be significant in this pancreatic disease group compared to the renal disease group as well as the control patients. And to conclude, among the underlying diseases, pancreatic diseases patients are the most susceptible to CDI, followed by malignancy groups in our setting. And CDI association with relation to underlying disease was more common with male gender, age more than 40 to less than 60 years, and patients receiving antibiotics. Further studies are required to investigate the association of CDI in underlying diseases within groups analyzed due to their complex pathophysiology. So high association of CDI was seen in patients with various underlying diseases, particularly pancreatic group and malignancy group, and it signifies requirement for precautionary policies such as antimicrobial stewardship and strict compliance, hand hygiene, and environmental decontamination. Despite routine steps being taken to curb infection with a hospital infection control committee, we found no decrease in CDI cases in the hospital when we reported this. And various factors may account for this, because patients are referred from other lower centers where implementation of infection surveillance is not available. These patients are already on antibiotics previously when they reach the hospital, and because of uncontrolled use of antibiotics, there is difficulty in controlling the patients. So I have come to the end of my talk, and now in this forum, though most of the speakers have left, I still request remaining speakers, and I request Dr. Deepinder Chinna to contact the speakers who have gone so that they can give their update on gastrointestinal infections for our journal on gastrointestinal infections as review articles, so that we can keep the show running. And with this, I thank you all for a patient listening.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for in just such a short time for making us aware of various research aspects and research papers which you all have done for this Clostridium difficile infection. Now the topic is open for discussion. Any comments, questions from the audience?
Ma'am, I have a question. Among the, you said the highest association was found with pancreatic diseases. Which particular pancreatic disease are we alluding to? Is it acute, chronic, acute?
It is acute pancreatitis. Most of these patients were having acute pancreatitis. Majority of these patients. Though we have also done a study, we are just analyzing the different groups in the malignancy group, where we have found, we have not published it yet, we have found patients with pediatric solid tumor and adenocarcinoma patients having higher this rate of CDI. We could not, we wanted to even look into the pancreatitis cases if there are different risk cases, but we found this. We have not taken malignancy cases in the pancreatic group. All malignancy cases, including those of pancreatic malignancy, were taken in the malignancy group. And same was true for the other group.
There are no questions. We move on to the second lecture.
Okay,
thank you, ma'am. Thank you. The second speaker is my good friend, Dr. Vipul Gupta. He is senior physician from Bathinda.
Jab We Met fame, right? He is a physician, senior physician. I will call him, he is a physician come social activist, right? And every week you will have his article in various newspapers on various aspects of